Let's turn to Psalm number 11, and this morning, in the will of the Lord, we'll continue our study in this psalm. Psalm number 11 and verse number 1. In the Lord put I my trust. How say you to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? For lo, the wicked bend their bow. They make ready their arrow upon the string, that they may privily shoot at the upright in heart. If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try the children of men. The Lord trieth with righteousness, but the wicked and him that loveth violence his soul hateth. Upon the wicked he shall rain snares, fire and brimstone, and an horrible tempest. This shall be the portion of their cup. For the righteous Lord loveth righteousness. His countenance doth behold the upright. Amen. With God's word open before us, let's seek the face of God. Pray that the Lord would speak to your heart today and those around you. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come afresh to thank Thee for the living Word of God. We thank Thee, Lord, that we have read truth this morning. We thank Thee we have read the revelation of God to man. We thank Thee, Lord, for those who were used of God to record the Scriptures. We thank Thee for men such as David, who were moved along by the Spirit of God And record it, Lord, which thou hast said. We thank thee, Lord, that the Holy Ghost has preserved this word right down till today. We thank thee, Lord, it is alive today. Lord, it's as real as it ever was. And we thank you, Lord, it still has the power to change lives. And we come this morning to God's house, and that's our desire, that lives would be changed, that God's people would be changed to be more like their Savior, and that the lost would be changed from sinners to saints. We thank thee, Lord, the word can do this. We thank thee, Lord, that the Holy Ghost can do this. And we pray, Lord, that thou wilt take thy word and write it upon hearts this morning. Lord, give us open hearts, we pray. Lord, help us to be open to the word of God and to what thou would say to us through it. Lord, so often we want to hear what God would say, and then we'll decide what we'll do. But Lord, I pray this morning you give us humility. And you'll give us that hungering and thirsting after righteousness, that we may be filled as we hear thy voice. I pray, Lord, that thou wilt give us that delight to do thy will, O God. And we pray, Lord, with the words of the psalmist, that thou wilt open thou mine eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. Lord, this is thy word. Open it to us this morning, we pray. I pray, Lord, that each heart will be captivated with Christ. And I pray, Lord, that thou wilt empty me of self and sin, fill me with the Holy Ghost. Lord, I need thy help. I need thy power. I need thy wisdom. And I pray for thy anointing this morning, that I might honor thee in this place, for I ask it in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Last Lord's Day, we were considering verses 1 to 3 of Psalm number 11. And in the first verse, we were really considering the wonderful truth that the Lord is a great object of trust for the Christian. Each child of God has a great God to trust in, a wonderful Savior, a merciful and precious friend. Now, this trust, of course, is not just speaking about salvation alone, but it's speaking about trusting every day, a continual trust, living for every day, no matter what your circumstances, regardless of your situation, whether you be rich or poor, our God doesn't change. He is the faithful one upon whom we can always depend. And I trust this past week you've been living in the knowledge that this God, the God of the Word, is your God, your personal Lord and Savior. He is a faithful God. The hymn writer said, he gives pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. His own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning new mercies I see. All I've needed, his hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. And you know, as you turn on the news and you look at the world today and how wicked it is and how vile it is and how it seems to be that sin is the norm, how can a man or a woman, a boy or a girl get up in the morning and face the world with happiness or with joy or with peace in their heart? There's only one way, and that's in Christ, by putting their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we went on to consider in verse number 3, a very solemn statement. If the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? And we had commenced last week by asking the question, what is the New Testament church? And we found it was a church that was built upon a foundation, built upon certain things that make it a true church. And last week, we only got one finished, and it was a church that is centered or built upon Christ, Christ in its purpose, Christ in its preaching, Christ magnified. And when Christ is magnified in the church, then the Holy Ghost comes in, and the Holy Ghost fills the church, and the Holy Ghost uses the church. That's the first foundational requirement of a true church of Jesus Christ. It is a church that is centered upon or built upon the Lord Jesus Christ. But the second foundational truth for a true church that we're going to look at this morning is this. It is a church that is built upon Holy Scripture. It is a church that is built upon the Word of God. In the early 1500s, there were many people who got saved in France. And in the court of the king at that time, there were many people who became born-again Christians. And the king was alarmed because of the change in his court, the change of behavior, the change of attitude. The people acted in a different way. They treated each other in a different manner. Their actions and their words were very different to what they had been before. And the king was so curious that he wrote to John Calvin. And he asked him what this new religion was that had come into his land and into the courts of his palace. And Calvin wrote back to the king of France to say that this new religion was in reality a return to Holy Scripture. That's what it was. It was a return to Holy Scripture. It was a reformation, a going back to the truths that had always been. You know, the Reformation, when it occurred in the Dark Ages in Europe, was not a new teaching. It, in fact, was a rediscovery of the old teaching, the teaching of the doctrines of Scripture, of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what caused the Reformation, getting back to the book. Up until that point, the church, as it was, the established church, had become very religious. It was very taken up with ornamentation within the church, with the rituals, with what you did within the building, and the preaching of God's word was shut out to the degree that it was the Dark Ages, because there was no light shining at all apart from a few secluded pockets across Europe. Then the Lord raised Calvin, and he raised Luther and Zwingli and all those different men of God who were raised up to call people back to Scripture. That's what their life message was. Come back to the book. You see, Calvin believed that the Bible was more than a revelation about God. The Bible was a revelation of God in order that we may come to know and serve him. And if you're going to know the Lord, and if you're going to serve the Lord, there's only one basis and one foundation upon which you can do that, and that is upon the Word of God, because this is our rule of faith and practice. Any church that is not built on Scripture, or who removes the Scripture from their central place, is unstable and will fall. Now, we have seen that throughout church history. You can open the history books today and find churches that were on fire for the Lord because they preached the Word of God, and then man's opinions became more important than God's Word. They started preaching what people thought was more acceptable. They started preaching what people wanted to hear. And yes, maybe the crowds came in. But as the crowds come in, Christ left. And you'll find there's churches today that once were used mightily by God to see thousands of people saved by the preaching of God's precious word. And you go in and you'll seldom hear a reference to the Lord Jesus Christ. The book will seldom be opened. That is not the church. The church must be built upon Holy Scripture. Why does the majority of our service of worship this morning be taken up with the preaching of God's word? Because it ought to be central in the worship of Christ. Worship isn't just singing. Worship isn't just praising. Worship isn't just praying. Hearing and reading and preaching God's word and hearing God's word and obeying God's word, that's worship. That is worship. This is a worship service from beginning to end when we have Christ central through his word. And we must have the word because man is so fickle. A man can wander and wax warm and cold, and he get notions into his head. And it's important that every time we say something, we have to come back because this is what God's word says. That's a solid foundation. That's a sure foundation, and one from which you cannot be moved. Now, there's three times in the scripture a warning of adding to or taking from the book. Three times there's a warning given from God from adding to this book and taking from it. We must accept scripture as it has been given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. When God's word is central in a congregation and in the preaching of a church, then man's thoughts and man's desires are placed below that. There's a danger that man's thoughts and desires can be placed above God's word. But when God's word is preached, then God's word is preeminent. And this was at the heart of the Reformation. Luther's conviction was to be faithful to the Lord. In 1520, he said that the church had to be built upon the absolute authority of Scripture. In other words, every word is true. You can't pick and choose. You can't say, well, I agree with that and I don't agree with that. You either accept it all or you reject it all. This is God's word. This is the living, revealed word of God. It's a foundation that has been given. You go back to Deuteronomy and you'll find that the Lord told the people in the book of Deuteronomy that they were to love the word of God. They were to bind it upon their foreheads, upon the doors of their houses. Why? Because it was to be central in their lives. Child of God, this morning, the word of God is to be central in your life. I trust and pray that it's not just central when you're in church. I trust and pray that you've opened the book since the prayer meeting. I trust and pray you've opened the book since last Sabbath day. I trust and pray you've been living in God's word. We were thinking of the importance of doing that this morning in the Bible class. Oh, the blessings there are in the word of God. And we were saying this morning, people are inches from the blessing because the Bible sits in the bedside table or it sits in the coffee table at home. And you know, they're inches from blessing, but they miss out on so much. Not only that, if you're not in God's word, then you're going to be unstable. And when the winds of doctrine blow and false teaching comes, you'll not be sure. We need to be in God's word. The word of God tells us in Psalm 119, it's the longest chapter in the Bible, it's the longest psalm within the book of Psalms, and within it, it tells us so much about the word of God because it's all about the scriptures. It tells us there's blessing, there's cleansing, there's guidance. The truths about the word of God are a delight to the psalmist's heart, and it ought to be to the child of God also. And in 2 Peter, we read how the Spirit of God carried along the man of God who wrote down the word. Friend, this isn't man's word, this is God's word. And we need to get that into our heart. And whenever we read God's word, and whenever we find that the word is from God, then the words that we can use to describe God, we can use to describe his book. You see, God is holy. This is holy. God is pure. This book is pure. God is undefiled. This book is undefiled. God is a living God. This is a living book. God is life-changing. He takes a sinner and changes him and transforms him. This book is a life-changing book. Our God is unchanging. He does not change. And thank the Lord, his word doesn't change. It's forever settled in heaven. And you know, the word of God must be known, it must be obeyed, and it must be guarded. And we must have a very high view of the word of God. If you want to do outreach for the Lord, you come to God's word and you'll find the book that will tell you how to do outreach in God's way. If you want to live daily for the Lord in a godly manner, come to the book. It'll teach you how to do that. If you want to know how church government ought to be run, come to the book. If you want to know about discipline, come to the book. All these things, doctrine, edification, these things are in the book. And that's why the book must be central. We can't go man's way. There's one way. It's God's way. It's a path of righteousness. And therefore, we must be built upon it as a church and personally and individually as Christians. Now, as we're thinking about this foundation, the foundation of the Word of God, it reminds us today that there is a great attack upon the authority of Scriptures. Now, there are many Christians who are taken up today with things that aren't really important. They're concerned about things that aren't important, that in the end do not really matter. But here's one thing that the church is under attack for in a very great way. And I believe each Christian should be on their knees praying about this, because this is something that is essential to the church of Jesus Christ. Now, of course, it's not known as an attack on Scripture. It's not called an attack on Scripture by the attackers. But it's dressed up in a very seemingly scientific term, the term of evolution. You might say, well, why is that an attack on the Scripture? Well, evolution is a belief that there is no God, that we were not created as rational beings in the Garden of Eden. It's a belief that we evolved from little organisms. We're evolving, we're getting better, we're improving. Now, you look at the history of the world and you will find that does not correlate. The reality is that while we believe in creation as God's people, and that is a religious belief, and it's right to call it that, evolution is also a religious belief. There is no scientific proof for that, and yet it is preached as science, it's preached as gospel truth. Ken Ham, who has given his life to preaching about evolution and creation, showing how creation is biblical, how creation agrees with science, and exposing the folly and the falsehood of evolution, says this, that evolution is a religious position that makes human opinion supreme. There is no God. They take away God. And the fruits of evolution, because they reject a creator, and if there's no creator, then there's no law giver, and no law. The fruits of evolution are lawlessness, immorality, impurity, abortion, racism, and a mocking of God. Now, does that not describe the world today? Does that not describe the vast majority of people among whom we live and move? Yes, it does, because they are building their life upon this premise. There is no God. There is no lawgiver. There's no judge. I won't have to answer to anybody. In other words, I can do what is right in my own eyes. That's the description of what the judge of the time of the judges in the Word of God. Each man did that which was right in his own eyes. They left God aside. But he also goes on to say that creation is also a religious position based on the Word of God. And its fruits, through the Holy Spirit, are love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Now, what should the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ do to go against the opposition of the preaching of evolution? Well, I believe there are some things that people do that are wrong, and I'm going to leave those with you first of all. There are those who put their time and their energy into explaining God to people. Now, you read God's word, and God does not ask any man or woman, boy or girl, to explain him. God asks you to declare him. We are to declare God. We are to preach the word. If God says it, we declare it. We're not to seek to prove and to explain, but by faith we proclaim the word of God. That's the means men and women are saved. Men and women are saved whenever God's word is preached and the Holy Spirit takes that word and places it within the heart. There are evidences of that in this meeting today. Because there was a time you came to church, maybe even this congregation, and the preacher preached, and you did not love the word of God. You didn't receive the word of God. You didn't agree with the word of God. You rejected it. Just like those who set themselves above the wisdom of God, so to you. You were your own God. And that's all you lived for. What you thought was right was what held. You didn't love God's law. You didn't live by God's law. But the Lord opened your heart one day. How did the Lord open your heart? It wasn't by viewing scientific experiments. It wasn't by listening to definitions. It was when God's word came into your heart. And that is how God's word penetrates through the heart, by the Holy Ghost. We need God's word. There are also some people who shy away and say, well, you know, the opposition's too great. It cannot be defeated. We must remember that God is able to deal with every opponent of the gospel. There's none too strong for him. There is none too great for him. Prayer is the greatest weapon for the church, and it is strong when it's on its knees. And the command of God is this: preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. And it seems to be that the preaching of the gospel is out of season. People don't want to hear it, but God says, preach on. Pray on, child of God. Get on your knees and pray that this would be exposed. Pray that people will come back to the basis of God's word. And then the other problem is this: some people attack the fruits of evolution rather than the foundation of it. You know, lawlessness, immorality, impurity, abortion, racism, mocking of God, these are age-old problems, and governments have tried to deal with them. Churches have tried to stand against these things. Yet they're only fruits of the foundation. They're fruits of the foundation. They attack our foundation, which is the basis of the Word of God. And we're simply attacking their fruits. We need to pray against evolution. And we need to pray that it'll be exposed for the falsehood that it is. And people's eyes will be open to see the truth, that God's word is true. You see, the root is this: they have removed God from their thinking. They've removed God from their life. In the United States, they've removed God from their schools. And whenever you remove the Lord, then there is no basis, there's no foundation. How do we fight against such beliefs? How do you reach those who will not hear that there is a God, who do not believe that there is a God? We do so through the preaching of the gospel. And you say to me, is that all? Thank God that's sufficient. It's sufficient. The preaching of God's word, it's the power of God unto salvation. In a few moments, we'll be looking at the foundational doctrines of Christianity, the gospel, and seeing what it is that must be taught. But suffice to say for now, it's the gospel that must be taught. That is the foundation. You know, in John's gospel, chapter 5, verse 46, the Lord Jesus Christ said, "For ye, had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words?" Now, the Lord referred to Moses. The Lord referred back to the book of Genesis. The Apostle Paul referred back to the book of Genesis. Now, the writings of Moses are the first five books of the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So therefore, the Lord has validated that Genesis is accurate. It is the word of God. The Apostle Paul validated it's accurate. It is the word of God. In fact, the Lord said, Abraham said, "If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead." They will not be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. The other foundation that I want to speak about this morning in relation to the church is this. A church is something that is built upon Christ, it's built upon Scripture, but also this, it's built upon evangelism. This is one of the foundational elements of a church. And you will find that when a church is based on Christ and it's reading God's word, then the natural result will be an evangelistic church. One of the great writers of the past said, you either evangelize or you fossilize. We must go forward in reaching the lost for Christ. The command of Scripture is evangelize. It's in Matthew's gospel, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You know, this is not an option. This is a command to every believer, to the church of Jesus Christ. Now, you're either fulfilling that this morning or you're not. We just read out about the offering for the missionary work, the retiring offering for the missionary work. And there are those who put money in, and therefore you're facilitating the spreading of the word of God across the world. You can't go, but you can support those who are there. That is a means of sending the gospel forth. There are those in this congregation we know who pray. You pray for students, and you pray for missionaries, and you pray for preachers from different lands and different places. That is a means of sending the gospel forth. There are those who actually will go forth. There are those who help in the Vacation Bible School. There are those who are Sabbath school teachers, Sunday school workers, outreach workers, senior citizens workers, tots workers, all these different range of people. And you're facilitating in the spreading of the gospel. But do you see, whenever that stops, then they're disobedient to the command of the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to pray that the Lord will give us that burden for evangelism. And you know how it comes? It comes through the word. Comes through the word. Whenever the Lord places upon your heart that you must be in that place to tell that child, when you must be in that place to tell that teenager, when you must be in that place to tell that person who needs a word from the Lord, then you'll be found there faithful. How wonderful when somebody can say, well, I've been called to this work. That's what we desire. The Lord will call people into works. The Lord will call people into service. The Lord will call people into avenues where they can serve him. What does that mean practically? A church that is evangelistic, it means Christians who are evangelistic. It means when a visitor comes into a congregation, you don't look them up and down and try to figure out who they are. You go over and you welcome them. That's what it means. That's a very practical thing, but a very important thing. It means that we will invite others to come and hear the gospel. Whenever the gospel is being preached, we'll invite others. We'll bring the gospel to other people. There's people who won't come to church. We know that. But, you know, you can bring it to them. You can bring a CD, you can bring a DVD, you can bring a book, you can bring God's word, you can bring a gospel tract. We'll be people who will pray for opportunities and wisdom to execute these things. And we'll view the world with spiritual eyes. You know, as a church, to keep silence is the highest in gratitude. And to tell others is the greatest privilege. Remember the lepers who were outside Samaria and the city was besieged. And whenever the enemy had gone away, they found that there was treasure and there was food, and the people were inside and they were starving and they were dying from the famine. And the lepers found the store of food and they started eating, and then they turned to each other. And you know what they said? They said, we do not well. We do not well. This is a day of good tidings and we hold our peace. And they knew there was going to be punishment because they were not telling others about the good things that were provided just a few steps away. And friend, we do not well. You do not well. I do not well if we hold our peace while others around about us are going to hell and we do absolutely nothing to try and stop them. How much more should we be concerned for the unsaved when we see the blessings and the richness of the Lord Jesus Christ? Him writers say, give me a heart for others that I might win them for thee. You see, the world has lost the power to weep over its sin. But unfortunately, the church seems to have lost her power to weep over the world. We need to get that back again and pray that the Lord will use us. Give us a watchword for the hour, a thrilling word, a word of power, a battle cry, a flaming breath, a call to conquest onto death. A word to rise the church from rest, to heed the master's high behest. The call is given, ye hosts, arise. The watchword is evangelize. To fallen men, a dying race, make known the gift of gospel grace. The world that now in darkness lies, O church of Christ, evangelize. Now we've been thinking about the foundational elements of the church, and we're going to now think about the foundations of the faith. Now, these are not two different foundations. They're the same foundation viewed from different angles. The only foundation for a man or a woman or a boy or girl to stand upon with safety is Christ and Christ alone. He is the only foundation. You know, the Lord said in Isaiah, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. See, Christ was prophesied to be the foundation for the church and for the child of God. If you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, you'll find that very clearly Christ is revealed to be the foundation. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 9. It says, we are laborers together for God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Christ Jesus. He is the foundation. In Ephesians, we're told that we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. And then turn to Luke chapter 6, and you'll find then the very familiar parable that the Lord used that reminds us of the importance of being standing on the right foundation. Luke chapter 6 and verse number 47. Whoso cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built an house and digged deep and laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation built an house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. Friend, it matters this morning upon what you've been building. Here are some of the foundations of the faith. Here's one which has to be held, one which must be built upon. By nature, all are lost in sin. By nature, all are lost in sin. You see, this teaches us the need of salvation. We need a Savior. Why? Because we're sinners. Why? Because by nature, we're born as sinners. You see, we need to present the sinfulness of man. Christ must be presented as a Savior. Now, we can't present a Savior if no one needs saved. You see, a person doesn't seek a fireman unless there is an issue with a fire. A person doesn't seek a lifeguard unless he needs to be saved from water. Thus, the man who is in his sin will never seek a Savior unless he knows he needs to be saved. Interestingly, this need for salvation, the origin of sin, its effects and its destructive outworkings are detailed in Genesis 3, the part of the Bible that's under attack today. Man says you can believe the Bible, obviously not the first 11 chapters of Genesis. Why? Well, they say it's unbelievable. The real answer is this: it presents man as he really is, and it's not an attractive picture. You see, there's false teaching today in churches, people will say, well, you know what? You just need the Lord to come into your life. Add the Lord to your life and everything will be perfect. You have a God-shaped hole in your heart and you just need the Lord to come in there. But that's nothing to do with Scripture. The Word of God says you need to be transformed. You need to be made a new creature in Christ Jesus. The Lord Jesus Christ isn't an add-on. The Lord Jesus Christ is everything or nothing. And if you're not saved this morning, you do not need Christ added to your life. You need the Lord Jesus Christ to cleanse you by his blood and to transform your nature. That now as you're unable to love God, you're given a love for God. Now as you're able to obey God and honor the Lord, you will be given the grace and the strength and the power to be able to do that. You don't need an add-on. You need a complete transformation from within. Some people say you need your life cleaned up. That's wrong. The Lord doesn't clean up people's lives. The Lord gives them new life, eternal life, a clean life, a holy life. Some people say you need to join a church to be saved. Friend, you can be saved without joining a church, although if you are saved and you're walking with the Lord and you're reading God's word, you'll find you should join a church. But joining a church is not anything to do with your salvation. It doesn't save you. Sadly, today there are people, and you ask them, how do you stand before God? And you know what they say? Well, I go to this church, or I go to that church, or I go to my church. If that's all you have to hold today, child of God, doesn't matter what church you go to, or unsaved, it doesn't matter what church you go to, if church is all you're holding to, you need saved, you need Christ. You need Christ this morning. The heart, the nature needs to be dealt with. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And therefore, this morning, what I'm saying is, this is one of the foundational truths and doctrines of God's word. Man, by nature, is sinful. Because a man doesn't realize that, he'll never be saved. The other foundational truth I want to leave with you this morning is this. Only the blood atonement can save the sinner. Only the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ can cleanse us from sin. You see, there are many who preach salvation but leave out the cross. They leave out the blood. Yet the Lord Jesus Christ told us so clearly in his word, the prophets prophesied it, the apostles preached it, that it's through the life and the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ that we can be saved. It's the only way we can be saved. It's through the cross work. It's through what he did on the cross. That transaction between God and man. That day when the veil was pulled across and man could not see what God did to his son. It's the shedding of the blood that is our salvation. From the shedding of the blood in the Garden of Eden, when the skins were made as a covering for Adam and Eve, through to the sprinkling of the blood in Egypt on the doorpost, to the prophecy of the lamb slain in the book of Isaiah, up to the cross of Calvary, there's only been one method of salvation, and that's the blood. That is the blood alone, by depending on the blood. We sang a few moments ago, on the golden streets of heaven, all men hope to walk someday. Yet so many are not willing to accept the living way. But while others build on good works, or opinions if they may, hallelujah, hallelujah, I'm depending on the blood. In the soul-cleansing blood of the Savior, I've been washed in the crimson flood. Though the world may say there is hope some other way, I'm depending on the blood. Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of the blood, there's no remission. There's no remission. And if you leave the cross and the blood out of the preaching, then you're not preaching the gospel. The third foundation of a faith is this, that a Christian is someone who has been justified in God's sight. Now, a Christian is someone who has come to God in repentance of sin. Lord, I am leaving my sin. I am coming to thee for salvation. They come in repentance and they come in faith. And the Lord declares them to be righteous. Now, this is a very important foundation because there are those who do not preach that. When a person is saved, the Bible tells us that the Lord declares that person to be righteous. The Lord, when they're converted, the Lord views them as his own immediately. What a blessing. What a thrill to know that the Lord knows me, loves me, and accepts me as his own in Christ. You know, whenever you become a Christian, you're not on probation. Neither is there a possibility of you falling out of grace. When you are saved, it is an eternal work done by an eternal God, which no man or devil can undo. What shall separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord? Read the end of Romans chapter 8 and you'll find nothing, nothing. Though the accuser stand and roar of sins that I have done, I know them well, and thousands more, but Jehovah findeth none. You see, this is the hope of the gospel. This is a wonderful thrill of the gospel. I'm accepted now. I'm saved now. Yes, I have to wait until I get to heaven before my glorification, but right now I can experience the thrill of knowing Christ as my Lord and my Savior, peace with God and pardon from sin. And there are those, and you know something, they're truly saved, but they've been taught, well, you have to be very careful because if you do something wrong, you can lose your salvation. What an awful burden to live under. Waking up every day hoping you've done enough, hoping you're pleasing the Lord enough, hoping you're praying enough, hoping you're reading enough. Friend, it shouldn't be that a Christian is doing that to please God. It should be that a Christian is doing that because they want to honor God. That's the difference. You desire to do those things, not to appease an angry God, but to get to know and draw closer to and honor a loving God. Friend, that's what God is to the believer. He's a loving father. And we need to get down to remembering this. I am accepted. I can be no more accepted than I am right now. And thank God he'll never reject me because I am in Christ. Final one is this, and with this we're closed. This is another foundational truth, and sadly it's swept away in many places today. We are saved to be holy. We're saved to be holy. God's word says, be ye holy as I am holy. Now, I don't want you this morning to leave thinking, oh, he's going on about holiness and this is just something else he's berating us over. I want you to take that today as an encouragement. God says, be ye holy as I am holy. Now, the Lord would never have said that if he would not give us the power to do it, the power to fulfill it. I am encouraged today that God puts this in his word. Why? Because God takes the believer and he makes them holy. Now, we would like to be more holy. We'll never achieve pure holiness this side of eternity. But you know what? When you're walking with the Lord, you become more holy. More than you were yesterday, more than you were last week. The natural outcome of a Christian who has been changed within, he'd be holy. The natural outcome of a church in which Christ is central, they'll be holy. That's the work that the Holy Spirit does within. You see, the attribute even of the third person, the Trinity, the Holy Spirit dwells within. Well, friend, you cannot be but holy. If it's the Holy Spirit dwelling within your heart, if he has control, you're going to be holy. Not perfect, but you'll be holy. What's that mean? Sin will grieve you. Sin will grieve you. God will thrill you. The word will bless you. Fellowship and unity will bless you. These things are holiness. Remember, this is something we ought to pray for. Lord, thou hast commanded me, be ye holy as I am holy. Lord, I know my weakness. Will you fill me with thy spirit that I might be holy today? Friend, God will answer that prayer again and again and again, over and abundantly. And when a church moves away from this basic essential doctrine, friend, it won't be stable. How sad whenever people forget about the holiness of the believer. How sad whenever you come into church and people are very flippant and there's no reverence in God's house, there's no respect in God's house. Friend, that's not becoming of the Lord who saved you. That's not walking in the Spirit. And I've known people who claim and profess Christ, and you know, they've mocked holiness. They've mocked meek people, and they've mocked godly people. And people who wouldn't do things that other Christians are doing. And sadly, you'll find that the person who mocks the holy Christian most is the cold, carnal Christian. And that's sad, because as often the Christian who's not walking with the Lord will be the greatest discouragement to those who are trying to. How sad. How sad that there are those who claim Christ and mock holiness. Here's the standard. It's not man's opinion. It's God's word. This is the standard. Friend, live by this standard. Don't you worry about what anybody thinks of you. Don't you worry about some cold Christian says about you or claims about you. You follow the book, you'll honour the Lord, and you will be blessed. And I trust and pray as God's people will be reverent in his house, because I believe if we come into God's house in a reverent manner, we'll miss the blessing of God. We need to be reverent in the house of the holy. Final question is this morning. Friend, what's your foundation? What's your foundation? As a church, we need to be built upon Christ. We need to be built upon the word. We need to evangelize. We need to preach sin. We need to preach Christ. We need to preach the holiness of the believer. But when it boils down to it, there's one word to describe all those foundations. It's Christ. There's only one foundation. It's Christ. We've looked at different aspects of it this morning. Are you on Christ this morning? If you're in Christ this morning, thank God nothing can move you. Thank God you'll be in glory. Thank God you can be used. Thank God you can never fall out of the Father's hand. But friend, if you're not in Christ this morning, you're on sinking sand. And when the storm of God's wind blows in the judgment day, you'll be blown right into hell. But thank God this morning there's a rock upon which you can stand. There's a Savior who truly saves. There's blood that washes white as snow. And if you will come this morning to this Savior, you will know pardon from sin and peace with God. I trust you won't leave the house without that this morning. How sad to come to God's house and leave without him. come to the Saviour. If I can be of help, I'll be at the door. Please make it known unto me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank thee and praise thee for thy word this morning. We thank thee, O Lord, for the foundation of Christ. O Lord, we praise thee that we're standing upon him. We're depending upon the blood. And Lord, there's no more certain or sure hope than Christ and Christ alone. Lord, I pray that thou wilt open the hearts of those who are not saved this morning. O Lord, I pray you'll bring them to thyself. Lord, don't let them walk out this morning without Christ. Don't let them walk out without a Saviour. But Lord, cause them to turn and put their faith and trust in him. Pray for the God's people this morning. Lord, help us to enjoy being in Christ. Lord, help us to remember who we are. Help us to rejoice in what he has done for us. He's given us the victory to be holy. He's given us the security of eternity. We thank you, Lord, that you'll never leave us and forsake us. Oh, Lord, we pray that the foundations will never be removed. We'll never move in this church from the foundations of God's word, from the foundations of Christ, from the foundations of evangelism. Lord, keep us faithful, we pray. Lord, I pray that whoever stands in this pulpit, Lord, will ever preach the full counsel of God. I pray, Lord, that you'll give power each time the word of God is opened. And Lord, even in our Sabbath school rooms and every aspect of our ministries within this church, Lord, may Christ be central. Lord, help us not go down the line of the world to try and trick people into the church, but help us to preach Christ in all his fullness. And Lord, we believe thou wilt bring them. Lord, I pray you'll bless us, bring us this evening with expectancy within our heart, for we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.